Well, welcome, everybody. It's good that we're here. It's good that we're here to share our grief, to share our laughter, and to remember a very dear, very loving lady, Irene Jacob. I often tell families at the time of services or as we meet that one of my greatest joys in the ministry has been to be of assistance to families at the time of the loss of a loved one. It's a time where certainly our faith, if it ever is to find relevance, it happens at moments like this where indeed the rubber meets the road, and our trust in God and in His Son, Jesus Christ, becomes foremost in our minds, a place it very justly deserves. That having been said, may I offer a word of prayer to begin our time together. Well, gracious God, we do indeed come before you this morning with heavy hearts, saying goodbye to our mother and grandmother and cousin and friend. And we just ask your blessing on all of us here, and to provide in each of our hearts a reminder of your grace and goodness that doesn't only last from birth to death, but indeed is a promise for everlasting to come, as we will, like Irene has now done, enter into the embrace of your loving arms. And we ask this blessing in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Well, to begin, it's always good to have a little audience participation to get you into our time together. John's giving you a little brochure, but if you turn it upside down and open it, you'll find printed there the 23rd Psalm, words of confidence and comfort that I know Irene cherished, and is something that would be good for all of us to hear. If I may read the words that are printed in light face font, if you would reply with those that are printed in bold. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley,
I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long.
Amen. We have one of Irene's granddaughters that would love to come up and share some thoughts as well as of her own and her fellow compadres, please.
Hi, so my name is Kaylee and I'm one of her granddaughters, and I thought I'd just say a couple things and a couple stories from our family and, you know, on behalf of all the grandchildren. So we all have so many wonderful memories with Grandma. A lot of them, you know, just at the lake house and going fishing off the dock and going on the pontoon boat and just lots of laughs. And she was always smiling and so happy. We have wonderful memories together going up to the cabin for Thanksgiving and making crafts together with Grandma. She was very artistic and liked to paint, as well as quilting, because I'm sure I've all seen her many, many quilts. But yeah, we'd go up to the cabin for Thanksgiving and we'd get to see the first snow and do our stories. We went to the mall and we rode around carousels together. And parking was always a challenge, so we'd all cram together in the van as tight as possible. And, for me, I'll always remember her cinnamon rolls that we made on Thanksgiving and her Dutch apple pie. And I'm thankful at one point in time I was able to steal that recipe, so I'm glad that I'll always be able to make that and remember her. And then, of course, you know, after Thanksgiving, there's Christmas, and we all have those memories we'll cherish together. And, you know, when we were little and she was still working, she would actually stop in Christmas morning on her way home. And that always brought, you know, more smiles. But I think for all of us, Christmas Eve was always the highlight of Christmas. And Lyle, John, and my dad would always open up their presents. And as soon as somebody would open one of them, you'd hear the famous, "Oh wait, that one's for Lyle." And then John would open his, and, "Oh wait, that's for Larry." And, you know, amazingly, you know, Uncle Lyle always seemed to end up with the best one. But, but that was Grandma. She always made it, you know, memorable. And for my sister and brother-in-law, Ben, who couldn't be here, he also was able to witness one of Grandma's famous Christmas presents. So this was actually probably only 2-3 years ago. We were opening presents, and Ben started opening his, and he kind of laughed at it because it looked like it was a little candy bar, a little piece of chocolate, and it kind of had some smudges on it. A little bite of the corner was taken out, and Ben kind of came over to Grandma and said, "Grandma, what happened here?" "Oh, well, you know, Squirt tried to get it, but don't worry, I stopped him." We'll always remember that Christmas because of that chocolate bar. And then a few years before that, my sister, when she was driving down, you know, Grandma always came down to see us, like, play our sports, and she was always, even when we moved down to Ohio, she was still very much in her lives. And on one of those trips down, she and my sister were riding together, and they stopped at the gas station, and as per usual, she grabbed her, you know, self-serve hot dog, and Abby grabbed her snack, and Abby paid and asked if they were ready, and they left. And I guess a few minutes down the road, a couple miles later, Grandma hit the brakes and goes, "Oh shoot, I didn't pay for my hot dog." And that was, you know, that was our grandma. And we'll love her for it, and, you know, because of that, she'll never forget that car trip either.
Yeah.
It was those stories that, you know, we'll love and we'll cherish. And even though she's not with us anymore, she'll always be with us, and we'll continue to love her and think of her every day.
Thank you for sharing with us. The scripture I wanted to share with you this morning, it seems most appropriate for us to hear on this occasion, comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 6th chapter, beginning with the first verse. It's the very tail end of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And this is what Jesus had to teach then and what he has to tell us this morning. He says, "Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for then you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues or in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you are praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, For your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This is indeed the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, according to Jesus' teaching, much of modern-day religion has it all backwards. Filling auditoriums with crowds of people to sing and cheer with bright lights, loud music, and inspirational preachers is not necessarily what God expects from us. At least according to this biblical passage, God does not want our faith to be a show of public display. Rather, all that God really wants from us is a reverent heart, a heart that quietly acknowledges God's holy presence in all things. It's just that simple, and it's just that hard. Irene Jacob understood this. Irene was not one to make a big to-do about herself, and this included her faith and her hope in God. Simply and quietly, Irene was at peace with her Creator. She didn't have to pray out loud for everyone to hear, because Irene's life was a prayer. Without fanfare, Irene brought a sense of confidence and hope into any room. Her positivity radiated from her broad, toothy smile onto every person she met and every situation she encountered. In that regard, she had a perfect temperament, I think, for the nursing profession. Her caring spirit, alongside her calm demeanor, were just what the doctor ordered, so to speak, for any patient infirmed at Chelsea Community Hospital. And her good nature was also vital to her family life. Being married to Raymond Jacob Jr., aka Duke, for 60 years required, how shall we say, a bit of patience, actually a lot of patience. But no matter what kind of escapade Junior took her on, Irene was sincerely content to go along and to make the most of it. And that's not to say that Irene wasn't at times a bit stubborn or that she never lost her temper. Lyle recalls how Irene came unglued one hot summer's day when a rotten tomato went airborne, missed its intended mark, and went splat on the back of Irene's neck. Susie remembers that Irene wouldn't budge when she had her mind made up, especially in her later years. But these occasions were rare, dwarfed by Irene's care and compassion for friend and family alike. I think it's more than obvious to say that Irene understood what Jesus meant when he said, "Don't blow your own horn." With humility and grace, Irene went about her life caring for others more than she cared about herself, being grateful for what she did have, rather than resentful over what was missing. As an aside, I would be amiss if I didn't mention that that same dedication was inherited by Irene's number one daughter, who so unselfishly looked after her mom these last years and especially these past few months. It goes without saying that Irene didn't make a big display of her faith. She didn't pray out loud so that others could see, but pray she did. Irene's life was an ongoing conversation with God. From the vegetable field to the athletic field, from handmade pretzels to hand-sewn quilts, from Manchester to Possum Hollow, Irene was a living example of grace and gratitude. Homegrown. Rest well, Irene. Your spirit lives on in the hearts of all of us who were so lucky to know you and so privileged to love you. Amen. Amen. God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants, who having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we thank you for your servant Irene Jacob, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of her life, for all in her that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave her that kindled in her the love of your dear name and enabled her to serve you faithfully. We thank you for that her death is past and pain ended, and that she's now entered into the joy you have prepared for her. Gracious God, in Jesus Christ, you promised many rooms within your house. Give us faith to see beyond touch and sight some sure sign of your kingdom, and where our vision fails, to trust your love, which never fails. Lift heavy sorrow and give us good hope, that we may bravely walk our earthly way as we look forward to glad reunion in the life to come through Christ our Lord. Now into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Irene Lydia Jacob. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forevermore. Amen. Amen. Let's join our voices together as we offer to God the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Let me leave you with a word of blessing and benediction, praying that the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the power that is the Holy Spirit enrich our lives as they have enriched Irene's life, not only this day, but for all of our days to come. Go in peace. Amen.